All right, we're done. Well, I was going to make you interact, but now, pressure's on me. I don't know how many of you read the bulletin this morning and saw the message that says, apples to apples. No, we are not playing a game today. I know, I'm sorry. But you are going to have to be interactive a little bit. You can't just sit there like you do with Scott. I'm going to have to get you involved, okay? So today we're going to talk about apples. I have a couple different apples here. How many apple fans do I have in here? How many people like apples? Raise your hand. All right. So you have to participate if you raise your hand. All right. How many of you, does anybody like a certain type of apple? I mean, does everybody like, or do you care? If it's red or if it's yellow, I'm eating it and that's it. All right, so I've got some here, and you just raise your hand if that's your favorite kind, okay? So let's start out here. First one is a Fuji. Any fans? All right, we got a couple. What are they good for?
Eating.
All right. You ask a stupid question, you just keep it in, right?
Throwing at the preacher.
He's not here, so you can do that when you come back. Gala. Any Gala fans? All right. What are they good for?
Eating.
All right. You got it right on it. Red Delicious. All right. Even Ivan. We got a teacher raised his hand. Is that what you want your students to bring? Red Delicious? All right. What are they good for?
Eating.
Any? There you go. Golden Delicious. Golden Delicious, all right. It's not as pretty. It's still shiny. It's not as pretty though, right? Apple juice? All right. Now this one's probably going to make everybody a little jealous of these other ones, all right? The Honey Crisp. Yeah, man. Look at that thing, right? I mean, I had these in my office for like 4 days. It's unbelievable what these apples smell like. I mean, they smell so good. That one, you look at it and you're like, well, those other ones, it don't hold nothing to it, right? Big one. Cabri, this is the one you wanted, right?
Yeah.
My favorite, okay, this is the one. I know you're probably going to be like, no way. My favorite right here. The old Granny Smith right there. Who's Granny Smith fans? Yeah. Right? Tart, sour, just like me, right? It's green, right? You can't go away. You can't be upset with green. You guys did good. I was glad you participated. I'm happy. Parts of the apple, all right? A single apple has many parts that make up the whole fruit. The skin. The skin is one of the most vital parts of an apple because the exterior shell skin protects the pulp by acting as a barrier. The skin is high in vitamin C, calcium, and potassium. But apple skins also have the ability to absorb toxins from pesticides and herbicides. The stem. Not many people think about the stem, but it's a part of the apple. The apple stem does contain some nutrition, such as fiber and iron. However, stems are typically thrown away because they are generally not tasty. I myself are not eating the stem. The stem, though, holds the core of the apple together and anchors the fruit of the tree, the fruit on the tree, as the apple grows. So without the stem, apple's not growing. The pulp, also called the flesh, is just beneath the skin of the apple. The part of the apple contains a great deal of nutrition, including pectin, vitamin C, calcium, and other minerals. The nutrients inside apples can potentially help improve digestion and may prevent certain diseases such as colon cancers. And last, and that's what I want to talk about today, is the seeds. The apple seeds are contained inside the core of the apple. The seeds contain fiber and minerals such as phosphorus. I know Cabri, she does not like the skin. So it's really aggravating when she wants an apple because either mom or dad's got to peel that thing. And now she's to the point to where she just, listen, you got to do it yourself. If you want it done, you do it yourself. So that skin, a lot of people don't like it either. It's the flesh, it's the inside. But today, the seeds are the important thing that I want to talk to you today. That's the main focus. You know, last year's theme, what was it? Anybody remember? Year of growth. I was going to say, Zoe, might have to have you stand up so we can remember last year's theme, the year of growth. Today, we're going to discuss that one more time. Let's pray. Father, just thank you for letting us be here together as a church family. Father, just let us be able to wrap around your word and let it sink in. And Father, just let us focus on you and put your son at the top. And Father, we just ask that you reach out and you guide us and lead us and let us be your hands and feet here on earth. We ask all this in your son's precious name. A couple years back, we moved from our farmhouse up at Winchester to where we're at now. But we had a big apple tree in the center of our yard. And I'm not a lazy person, but I do like to sit around in the fall, late summer, and just watch and listen and enjoy the beautiful days. And one day, we would go out to the barn. I probably was going out there to see my kitty cats. That's probably what I was doing. But you never walked underneath that apple tree if there was apples on it, because it was almost like God was playing a game with us, and he would make those apples fall off as hard as he could, because those things sounded like bricks falling off, did they not? And those things, they would hit, and you'd be like, whoa. So you would walk around the apple tree. And so I was just sitting there, and I was watching this, and I was watching the apples fall, and thinking the Lord's trying to hit me in the head. He's trying to help me. But I just kept watching. And this question hit me. The apple can't get very far from the tree. And I know you guys have heard that, right? But have you ever, how many people have apple trees on their farm or around their house? Have you ever looked at that? They can't get very far away from the tree, right? So how do apple trees grow? If they can't get away, how do they grow? I started thinking about that. The seeds, yeah. Started thinking about that. How many apple trees do you see growing underneath the big apple tree? Do you see any? It's what usually happens. I mean, they all die there, right? They all fall. And if you don't pick them up, they rot there, right? And then in the fall, you have bees that are going crazy around them, trying to get the pulp, the skin. But the seeds are still there. But why come they don't grow? Sometimes, we mow around that tree, and I'm sure some of them came up. I'm sure some of them got pressed into the ground before they started to grow. But you don't ever focus about that. When you mow, there could be one that sprouted up. You just mow it off. How do they get away? How do we get away from our sins, the shadow in our lives? How do we do that? And that's the one thing that kept running through my mind. How do we get away from what's overshadowing us? And so, this morning, I hope that we can understand that and try to see how we can grow. Matthew chapter 13, 3-8. This is Jesus talking, and this is what he said. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, a farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow. But when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still, other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. Let's go through those verses. Let's look at these things, and let's think. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Now, just hearing that, does that sound like a bad thing? Does it sound like a bad thing? Probably not, right? I mean, birds got to eat, right? Birds got to live. So at first you think that's not such a bad thing. And we go on. Some fell on rocky places. know, they're in shallow ground. There's nothing there. When the sun came up, it scorched them, and they died. They sprang up quickly, but they died. You know, just as that tree is blocking out the sun from the apple to grow, vice versa, if it falls on shallow, rocky soil, it's not going to grow at all. So it's going to come up, and then boom, sun scorching it out. And then we go on further, and it said, other seed fell among the thorns, which grew up. They grew, but it choked it out. It couldn't withstand. It couldn't get through. And then the last, which every farmer in here, you want your seed to land on good soil. You want it to be in that soil where it's full of nutrients, where it produces a crop 160 or 30 times what was sown. And all you I know the farmers here in Randolph County, I know that sometimes you can go into great soil and then you can go right out onto that hill where there is hardly any nutrients, that red clay. It's tough soil up there, especially when the sun's out, right, Daryl? Sun really bakes it in, makes it hard. You know, let's flip over to chapter 13, and let's get an explanation of what these things mean. And I think that you'll see there's a little bit of differences when you hear this from how he explains it in 18 through 23 in Matthew chapter 13. He says, listen to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears a message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in their heart. This is the seed along the path. Now, what happened to the seed along the path? The birds ate it up, right? It didn't sound so bad at first, right? Now, Scripture is saying, Jesus is explaining, this is the seed that is there, we don't understand, and the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in our heart. Snatches it away. The next, the seed falling on rocky ground refers to someone who hears the word and at once receives joy. Right? We've been there, right? I've been there. I've heard the word. I've received joy. I'm excited. I'm happy. But since they have no root, they last only a short time. Right? You go to that mountaintop and then you come down. When trouble or persecution comes because of the word, they quickly fall away. You know, in my younger years, when I didn't have the roots, yeah, I knew about Jesus, but I didn't know about him. I didn't know what he could do. I mean, just that song that we sang, the last one, I stand in awe of you. I'm in awe of you. I can relate to that. I mean, if I was sitting there and it brought me to tears thinking about that. That you're in awe of Jesus, of what he did for us. The seed falling among the thorns refers to someone who hears the word. But the worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke out the word, making it unfruitful. Wealth. We always hear that, you know, money's a bad thing. Well, Scripture shows us that Job was a very wealthy man, was he not? It's not being wealthy. It's how we let money control our lives. And Job didn't let that happen. And that's what it's saying here. It lets wealth control our lives. It chokes out the word, making it unfruitful. What does that mean? Bears no fruit. You cannot grow. And the last, but the seed falling on good soil refers to someone. And I look at this as this church body. This is how I feel about the church body. Meaning you guys. Okay? But the seed falling on good soil refers to someone who hears the word and understands it. This is the one who produces a crop yielding 160 or 30 times what is sown. I see this church, I see it grow. Do we have issues? Do we have stumbles? Do we have some times where we fall? Yeah, but we're always growing. You know, we watched a men's Bible study we were doing on Wednesdays, or FCA, and it was talking about, it was the movie, what was the movie, Brad? The football. Woodlawn. And the guy was a pitcher. I'm not sure where he was, where he pitched, but he's a National League pitcher. He got cancer in his arm. He had to have his arm taken off. But he said, what grows at the top of the mountain? What grows at the top of the mountain? Anything? What's up there? Ice, snow, rocks, right? Where's all the lush, green trees? All the beautiful stuff. Where's that at? In the valleys. That's where all your growing is going to happen. That's where I'm going to grow as a person, is in that valley. I can stand on that mountaintop. I'm not going to grow. You know, I think that's why I look at this church. I see us in those valleys sometimes, and I see us growing. I see myself growing, and then I see us hit mountaintops, and then we get there, and then we come back down, and we get in that valley, and we grow again, and it makes us stronger. It makes us be able to go out. Our message this year, here I am, send me. That's us. We know that there's going to be valleys where we're going to have to grow. Send us. Let us be able to go out and let everyone else grow. Let us be someone that can get that seed into the good soil. You know, today I want to ask you, which one are you of those scriptures that we just read? Falling on rocky soil? Are you among the thorns? Do you not understand the word? Or are you in good soil, planted and firmly rooted? We have struggles in our lives, and I understand that. But my prayer is that we get to where we're all firmly rooted in the word. And we understand it. And that way we can be God's hands and feet. And we can go out and help those grow. We flip over to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 5 through 9. The Lord gives us a task. Okay? It says, what after all is Apollos? And what is Paul? Only servants through whom you came to believe. As the Lord has assigned to each his task. I planted the seed, Apollos watered it, but God has been making it grow. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who makes things grow. The one who plants and the one who waters have one purpose, and they will each be rewarded according to their own labor. For we are co-workers in God's service. You are God's field, God's building. I think that is so important for us to understand. That we are God's field. Not just here, not these four walls, outside these four walls. We are God's building. And that message on our shirts this year, here I am, send me. That's what he's telling us right here. Go. Make somebody grow in the Lord. Let somebody understand the word so that they're not uprooted. So they're not among the thorns. So they're not letting the evil one take what's in their heart. And we all know what's in our heart is Jesus Christ. That's what we need to do. And it tells us, Scripture, it gives us a little bit of a momentum boost. Because it tells us, it says, they each will be rewarded according to their own labor. It tells us we're going to be rewarded. Heaven. That's our reward. Heaven. So, in closing, Scott told me I had to preach an hour. But I feel like with all the messes that have started, we're better off to just leave it at what it is. In closing, I have a couple apples that I want to show you, okay? Now, you were all were interactive before, and I want you still to be, okay? And I want you to be honest with yourself. And I want you to be honest with everyone here. Everybody know Doc Overlees? You can raise your hand. All right. This came off of his farm. It's been laying around outside. It's mushy. A little rotten. It smells. Anybody want this apple? No. What about this one? It's been ate off of. It's brown. It's all disgusting. Okay? Anybody want that apple? No. Here's my question to you guys this morning. What's the difference between those two apples? What's inside both these apples?
Seeds.
You know, as bad as those are, you get the seeds out of those, and you plant them on fertile soil, they'll be just like this. Beautiful apples, right? How many of us got some bruises? How many of us in here have got some bruises, maybe some scars, maybe some things that affected our lives that we changed? We were able to grow. We were able to get out of that thorny, rocky soil. We were able to get away from what snatches that seed away from us. We were able to get away from that. We were able to get away from Satan so that we could be fruitful and produce 100, 60, or 30 times more. What I want you guys to understand is there's a lot of people in the world that are lost, that are hurt, that still have that seed that says in Scripture was sown where? In their hearts. It's our job this year to be sent out to try to save those that are lost, because we are Jesus' hands and feet. We are his field. We are his building. That's our job. Get those to fertile soil. Get those seeds to fertile soil and let them be fruitful. I want to close with one last scripture. I think it's very important that we listen to the words of what it says. 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 22 and 23. This is what it says. It says, "Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for each other, love one another deeply from the heart." From the heart. "For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, through the living and enduring word of God." We've been born again. Jesus has came to save us. He didn't come to condemn us, right? John tells us, John 3:16-17 tells us, he didn't come into this world to condemn it. He came to save it. And it tells us we have been born again, not of a seed that's perishable, but a seed that is imperishable, that will continue to grow forever. Let's pray.